first thing I want to do is kind of set a couple of introductory statements to kind of put this in context. First of all, I want to keep this very, very informal. If you have questions, if you don't understand something, please speak up. It's probably other people feel exactly the same way. Second thing I want to tell you is this: I'm not here to sell or convince you of anything. Please know that. The only thing I'd like to do is have you think outside the box of why you're even thinking about building a program. The truth is that most of us are followers, and we follow what's been done. And you'll see throughout this next hour that I believe pretty emphatically that what's been done is not good. It does not represent our experience in the wild. It doesn't represent the investment we have. It really isn't telling the story that we wanted to tell. But in most cases, we don't think there's an option. Now, I want to make this also very clear. It may well be you don't agree with anything I have to say. Perfect. I'm okay with that. But at least you've heard another side. And I want to warn you in advance, it is another side. And I want to keep that in mind. The last thing I want to tell you as far as where we get started is that the whole procedure of planning, building, and living in a trophy room should be characterized by fun. This is a discretionary spending. You're not paying your taxes, and incidentally, I'm disappointed that most of you have not paid your fair share. You're not building your business, even though you have all kinds of help from other people to build it. This is at the end of the taxes, the end of the sacrifice, the end of all the necessary expenditures. This is yours. This is what you get to do with a significant portion of your life. And the first thing I want to say about that, and we're going to conclude with it too, you got to stop feeling guilty. None of it was handed to you. I know for a fact. And yet, in the culture we live now, if you are that 1%, you're an evil, self-greedy individual. I do not buy it. And it applies to what you're going to do with the rest of your life. You don't feel the freedom to do what you really want to do because of the guilt. I speak of myself. We're in the fourth quarter of our life. This is the last shot we've got to do what we really want. And most of our lives is characterized by, I have to. This is something you don't have to do. This is something you get to do. This is something that's supposed to be fun. This is something that you should savor without apology and without guilt. Okay? With that in mind as the background, I want to tell you a true story that knocks me out. In 1994, a group of archaeologists and geologists were working in the south of France. They came across a huge stone face. As they worked across that stone face, they sensed a current of air coming through a fissure in the rocks. Knowing geography, they knew that it may indicate a cave on the other side. They opened up that fissure so they could slither through, and with their lights, they saw this beautiful cavern and figured it was just a geological formation. But as they moved forward, at the back of the cavern, they discovered something. They discovered the very first images that man ever expressed. We know now that they were over 40,000 years ago. And that what had happened is that a mountain slide had come down and sealed that cave like a time capsule. So it was preserved pristine. It's been considered literally the greatest cultural find in history because it shows what our forefathers thought and expressed. I want to show you the images. Now, before I show it to you, I want you to understand something. You're a Cro-Magnon, you're a Neanderthal. Your life is totally consumed with survival. Not much different today. But in the middle of that harsh environment to survive, one day, for the very first time, a guy walks into this cave and he looks at this beautiful wall, this cavern. And while he's looking up at this cavern, something in the cortex of his brain, something from the well of his soul, burst out. An image. An image that was important to him, an image that meant something to him. And so he finds a pigment and he fashions a utility. And for the first time in human experience, he makes an image. What do you think the image was of? My apologies to Sigmund Freud. It wasn't a nude. He wasn't thinking about sex. It was close behind. What he saw, what came within him, what meant something to him from his unconscious, from his conscious to him, was animals. I want to show you those images, gloriously rendered by memory. These were not just animals. They were big game animals. They were the things that he had encountered in the course of his life. And when he had a moment of quietness in that cave, that's what he wanted to express. They know by carbon dating that people came back to that cave for over 5,000 years to observe those images and to add to them. They were even so sophisticated, as you see in that image, of showing motion. They were telling a story that was fundamental to their existence. Elephant with furry feet. Beginning, the wild horse, the beginning of the zebra. In the inner chamber, they went to a third chamber inside that cave. And in the third chamber, there was nothing but lions. They reverenced those lions so significantly that they made a chamber of them. It's significant to me that here we are in the 21st century. The emblem of Safari Club is a lion. What's at risk is the lion. And the iconic image of the international hunter is what? A lion. I submit to you, and I cannot back it up, but I believe that was the genesis, that was the first trophy room. What were they celebrating in that room? I'm going to offend people. I'm Irish. Get used to it. I don't intend to, but it's the truth. What were they celebrating in that room? They weren't celebrating mine's bigger than yours. I've got more than you do. They were celebrating the remembrance of an experience. And that's what I want you to focus on. I think when we build a trophy room, what we are really yearning for at the inner part is a place where we remember an experience. Listen, the trophy itself is nothing more than a symbol. It's a symbol of an experience. I'm sure you're listening. I remember at 13 getting up in the dark and lacing on my boots and going to the deer blind in the northern part of California and sitting there in the dark waiting for the first light and listening in the stillness and hearing the crunch of those leaves and being connected to the planet away from the television, away from the phone. I remember that experience. I remember in Africa walking through the tall grass and feeling that breeze and seeing the herd of buffalo kick up dust in front of me. That's the experience I remember. I remember with ice axe going up over into the glaciers above the timberline in Alaska and setting up a camp in a basin and actually being terrified because a storm was coming in and getting into that camp that night at that elevation, not knowing what would happen in the morning, and surrendering to the universe. And waking up in the morning and saying, I'm alive. I'm here. And pulling the tent back, and there were two dog ranches 100 yards away bed. I was in their world. And their world was my world. And that ram is a symbol of that experience. I believe that's what you want in your room. I remember in Africa one time I talked to my PhD, Simon, one of the greats. And I said, Simon, I don't want to keep riding around in a Land Rover. And so we put together a group of porters, and we hiked over the Great Rift all the way down to the bottom of the valley. Everybody was excited. Everybody. We had to get a Maasai to take us that nobody else knew. And they were seeing things they never saw before. And when we got, it was a 14-hour day. When we got down to the bottom, the porter set up the camp. And guess what? They forgot the food. There was a bag of rice. And you know what? We cooked it and shared it. Best meal ever. And in the morning, we hunted lesser kudu. And when I see that lesser kudu, I don't care how big he is, I remember the experience. Do you understand the distinction? It is day and night. I'm going to go even farther. There are two approaches to trophy rooms, and I know most of you, I don't want to judge. There are two approaches to trophy rooms. One is ego. Mine's bigger and I got more of it. The other is passion. Something outside of yourself. The people who look at trophy rooms as ego are no different than those who collect cars or art or stamps or coins. It's a collection that they purchased. Those who have passion put together a trophy room because it had an experience. It was something outside of themselves. In the first case, the whole purpose of the trophy room, come on, I killed that son of a bitch. I killed that son of a bitch, and I killed two of those. And what you're saying throughout the whole thing is, look at me. It's all about me. Other says, look at the planet. Look at the beauty. Look at the opportunity. Look at what I felt. I want to remember the experience, and I want this room to be an experience. Not a warehouse of dead animals. The sad truth is that there's been little development in the understanding or the building of trophy rooms in the last 40 years. We're stuck in the 60s. There's an old axiom that says we covet what we see. And here's where I'm going to really step in a bad way. That's why people buy the trophy room books. I want to see what the other guy's done, see if I can get some ideas. You know how smart that is? If you decided you wanted to have a new wardrobe, and you went into the attic and found an old Sears and Roebuck catalog, and you went through that catalog and said, this is what, it's outdated, it's irrelevant, and it's not you. And yet most of us can't think past that. There is little innovation, there's little creativity, and there is so much opportunity if we understand why we're doing this. But the key, now listen to me, the key is you have to determine your purpose. If your purpose is to exhibit a collection, that's different. If your purpose is to remember an experience, that changes. Remember Alice in Wonderland? Alice, are you lost? I don't know. Where are you going? I'm not sure that any role will get you there. If you're not sure where you're going in life, and specifically this morning in your trophy room, any role will get you there. It takes a monumental amount of focus and courage to say, this is what I want to say about my hunting experience. This is my story. Now, with that in mind, I'd like to share with you the two fundamentals that are essential to any trophy room. I'm going to show you some of these images. Let me say this in advance. Jane has not had a chance to go through this with me, so she's our office manager, she's my office wife, and so she has learned to have to stay up with me, and I get off on tangents, so the outline might not happen. So bear with that. Okay? The two fundamentals of a trophy room are space and design. And each affects the other. It's right hand, left hand, yin and yang. The amount of space you have will determine the design will turn into space. And you cannot overemphasize that. You're going to hear me scream about this for the next 20 minutes. Everybody builds too small a room. I've had three people at this convention coming to me, knowing we were doing this seminar, and said, tell them to build a bigger room. There's a couple reasons for that. The first is we really don't have a concept of when you bring animals indoors, how much space they take. The second of all, we don't have a concept of design. Now let me show this to you. The absolute basis of design is the following. For every positive object, it has to be surrounded by a negative shape. A place for your eye to rest. What characterizes most trophy rooms? Filling up every inch all the way through. Why? It's too small. Now, when you fill every negative space, let me tell you what it is. It's the same as in music. My wife's a music teacher. It's the same as in music. It is the rest notes between the notes that create the melody. If it's all note, 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 you've got noise. No rest, no melody, no design. Most trophy rooms are noise. I call them confetti. You ever watch me? Won the championship last week, and the confetti pours down, it blurs everything. Nothing stands out. And the reason for that is two things. They built the wrong room too small, and there was no design. So those are the two fundamentals. I want to stop right here. Anybody have questions? Either I'm brilliant, or nobody's listening. Okay. Let's talk about how you determine space. And let me just tell you this, because I know what's going through your head right now. You're going, God damn it, this is going to cost me a lot of money. Wait till the end, we'll talk about that. Okay? But I will tell you this in advance. I'd much rather have you build a small room with glass and paste than have a small room that's just a den of death with clutter. Those rooms do not respect the animal, and they do not tell your story. That's why you don't go out and buy trophies. You have to have the experience of achieving the trophy, but then you have to have a space to tell the story. That makes sense? Okay, Jane, space, next. Okay, I love this. What gets measured gets managed. We love to deal in generalities. One of the things I harp on with my staff is I don't care what you think, tell me the facts. Because the facts change what you think. We all have a bias, we all have generalities in mind. So you have to really measure. Okay, here's how we're going to do it. This is under the category of space. Here's what we're going to do. I want you to list all of the animals that you've already mounted. And if you really want to get good, life-size shoulder mounts, pedestals. List all of those animals. And even list the footprint that they're on. So you start getting the size, okay? Now when you sit down, here's how it's going to go. You're going to go this, okay, you make this list. Pick an eating, read it back. Have a drink. Then make another list. My 5-year plan is, and you list those animals. And have another drink. And then put down your bucket list. This is what I want ultimately in my room. This is why I'm building this room. Now, you're beginning to get an idea, but don't stop there. Okay. The next thing I want you to do is to list the other elements that you would like to see in your drawer. And let me emphasize this before we get there. You'll see some of them listed up there. Fireplace, bar, game table, television, seating area, art, artifacts. These are things I want in my room. I firmly believe in this. If your room is not livable, you will not enjoy it and you won't go there. You have to have it connected with your living space. You don't want to have a museum. And so you have to take a look at the space that those elements require. And now you finish the bottom. You see where we're going? Because let me tell you what happens, and it happens every time I go to a room. I start out with a design. I'm really excited. We've got negative space, we've got viewing angles, we've got traffic flow, we've got points of interest, we've got foundation points. We've got the things that make a room work. One of the great purposes of a trophy room or design is compression and release, places where you're under the room. Love it. And as the room is being put together, guess what happens? More stuff starts showing up. And you start jamming stuff in. And pretty soon, the design is gone, the impact is gone. And my staff knows this. I just turn it over and say, I did the best. I'm still waiting for the ultimate room. And it may never happen. But at least I want to put it in front of you as a possibility. Let me share a story with you. This guy cracks me up. This guy is in multiple. And he has a warehouse. And instead, let me tell you, if you want to make a trophy room out of an existing structure, we made them out of warehouses, airplane hangars, old barns, and existing homes. And I'm good using an old structure and reworking it. It troubles me that when we build the structure, we build our own problems. He has this huge, huge warehouse and worth gazillions. And he has multiple collections. And so when you come through the door, it's just confetti. And so I said to him, I said, how would you feel if we start to break this up? So there's kind of a sense of adventure, sense of discovery, blah, blah, blah. Not interested. I thought, okay, I'm going to go out even farther. Most of you guys who are good at business or good at numbers are lousy at aesthetics. Okay? It's left hemisphere, right hemisphere. I highly respect your ability to make money and count beans. I don't diminish that a bit. But you guys have also learned to be alpha males. And you're in charge. And sometimes you really miss the opportunity by not deferring to somebody who is using the other side of the brain. I barely graduated algebra. But I think the other side of the brain. And so you just need to recognize that that's what you need if you're going to do this kind of a room. Anyway, so couple weeks later, his assistant came to me and I said, what? And it was the money, it was the space, why do you want to do it? Here's what he said, literally, this goes back to the purpose of the room. He said he wanted it so that when people opened the door into his room, they saw all his stuff all at once and were impressed with him. That's sad. But unfortunately, that mindset is there. Okay. Now that we've begun to understand a little bit about the space requirement, we're going to go to the procedure. If you hold it for a second. This is one of my favorite rooms. This is Kevin Small out of Bakersfield. He and I have been buddies. We've hunted together. He's oil, so that'll tell you a little something. And he built this room over the course of a year. And what you see is a half life-size elephant behind it, in front of a mural, in front of a top of a bar. He's got two pop-up TVs, a bar there, seating area, the fireplace. To the right, it breaks out into an outdoor kitchen and a pool. And as you go up into the rest of the room, there's these dioramas. It's really a lovely room. But he came to me yesterday, and he's recognizing he has to expand. If you can't build it all at once, at least plan for expansion. Okay, so let's go back to procedure. And there's my answer right there. Whatever size you think you got, double. And that's not a joke. An empty room looks huge and fills up that fast. Okay, let's talk about the procedure. Oh, see, I told you. That's the room that worked. I'll show you one that doesn't work. That's Kevin's room. That's up in the upper stairs. See the open space? See the thing that's drawing you back? It's a lovely room. Okay, now let me show you what doesn't work. This is my client, too. I want you to know I'm not picking anybody else. Lovely, go back up, Jim. Lovely way of hanging heads on a wall and all in a row. Lovely way of clustering a mountain it has every conceivable animal on the planet. And it has no design, it has no negative space, no place for your eye to rest. And I've been in that room, and he talks about a specific animal, and he cannot even find it. But he's Iranian. What can I say? Okay, here's the procedure. You need to meet with the architect and the builder, keeping the purpose in mind. Now, I'm going to stop there. First of all, where is Steve? Steve, stand up. Steve is with Texas Timber Frame. Is Josh here?
Yeah, Josh, right here.
Josh, stand up. Josh is the one who built and installed the timber that you see in our booth. Thanks, guys. I met with these guys in Houston, and we're using them for this reason. At this point is one of the few architect builders who will stop and listen to the uniqueness of a trophy room. Most folks go right to the architect and builder and say, I want a trophy room, and the architect is out of his depth from day one. He's not a hunter. He doesn't understand design. He has a vague concept of a lodge in Glacier Park or a log home with a moose over the fire pit. And I'm going to tell you what's going to happen right now. I'm very adamant about this because I've seen my clients get burned on this over and over again. Those architects and builders not understanding the purpose of the room will overbuild the room. They'll take you down a garden path that's costing you way more money. And here's even the worst part. You'll spend more money, and what they'll bring to the table is so complex and convoluted that it is in contrast to the purpose for which you want to build. You want simplicity. The animals are the stars. You want a shell with a few accents. And I'm going to show you some of these other slides. You'll see where the architects and builders come with some wonderful things, beautiful things. But at the end of the day, it cost a ton of money. And in fact, okay, I got to tell you this. I got to got a guy in Northern California. He's been whacking and stacking for 7 years, leaving a studio, going to build a trophy room. So finally I say to him, you know, in trying to help him, and this is something else, there really is some kind of a mental barrier. It's, you keep going on hunts, you're good with that, you keep buying guns, all the rest of that, but you can't quite make the room. And so I try to help him out with that. I says, you know, we even, he had a big ranch, I says, you know, we even use barns, and I'll tell you, we have them. Love it. So we can recruit them. Light goes on. So I think, good, he's listening. He hires a contractor and a builder to build the most exquisite, it's not a barn, reclaimed lumber. It's just gorgeous. And he is so proud of it. So I send one of my guys out there to look at the interior of what he wants to do. And I quote him, he says, I just love the paneling. I love this timber. I don't want anything to obscure it. Excuse me? I want my, all my, we were talking about doing these, you'll see the other kind of options and creativity. He says, I just want my mounts simple on the floor so I can look all the way through and see that paneling and see the feet. That's called the tail wagging the dog. And how did it happen? Because the goddamn architect. And that's why I believe in these guys. I met with them, I explained the significance of a room, and they understood it that fast. I've met with other folks, and when you get a right architect and a right builder, they're listening. If they're not listening, you've got the wrong person. If you look at our display, we spend so much time and money to show you what we want to do. If you look at the display, the structure, I'd love to just stand back next time and look at it. The structure is a frame around the painting. Most structures become the painting. Never draw logs. Logs are the feature. You want simplicity, you want earth tones, so that you have the impression. Open shell that allows you to be creative. Once you've met with the architect and the builder, you meet with them and share all the information we talked about. Here's my mounted animals, here's what I plan to get, here's what I want in this room. Okay? When that, then the architect goes back and comes up with an initial drawing. Once we get that initial drawing, whoever's going to assign it to them, once we get that initial drawing, we build a model. And the model is a three-dimensional, I'm old school, it's not a computer-generated model. We build a model so that you can see what your room is going to look like. That is a wonderful opportunity for two things. One is for change, and one is for comprehension. You can make changes, or you can... And what will happen immediately, they go, oh, I didn't realize, we'll show animal placements, all right. They go, oh, I didn't realize. And they suddenly realize, they got one or two choices, increase the size or diminish what they put into it. You can't do both. When we get done with the model, then is the opportunity for us to agree on the general, then we start talking about the general principles of what's going to make this room work. The first thing I love to talk about is volume, and that's another reason I believe in Texas timber frame. That is an organic shape. Volume is so critical if you want to tell the story of your experience. If you have low ceilings, the room is heavy. When you step outdoors, that's that decompression. You walk out, and there's that openness. And these big arches allow you to do that. So I really am concerned about volume as much as I am about floor space. The other thing that we talk about is wall height. I'm just going to give you some general principles. Your wall height should be at minimum 12 feet, much better 14 to 15 feet. Your gable should be at least 20 to 25 feet. You need to have volume. That's the thing. Okay, now number four. Okay, this is my passion here. No windows. Two reasons. One, no matter what you put on a window, UV comes through and bleaches. Once an animal is bleached, it's burned, it's gone. But here's the other thing. Anything you put in front of a window becomes silhouetted. You can't see it. It's a shape. So by putting in a window, you've limited display space. Also, when you put in a window, you tell the viewer they're in a building. We don't want to tell them they're in a building. We want to tell them they're in Africa. So what do we do instead of windows? Oh, stop there. I told you what. This is Texas Timber. Do you see the volume we're hitting here? What a wonderful height. Look at that when you walk in. It's a cathedral. Okay, now, here's what we do in place of windows. We do murals. Just hold with Jane. First, I want to do something. I am incredibly proud of the quality of our murals, and that means I'm incredibly proud of our artists. And I'd like to have Bob Bucknell just stand up. Bob is the artist of our murals. He's been a great guy. And he's a great student as well. These are murals. Now let me tell you, go ahead and through them, Gene. Let me tell you what these murals do. They open up the room. Again, go back to our display. You're going to see it in work. Stop right there. Oh, this is great. I love this. Okay, this is where the architect really made a mess. Most of the time when we come in, it's called damage control. Don't you love the ceiling? Wonderful. What does it do to the room? Weighs it down. Don't you love the floor? It's exquisite. 80% of it was covered. You know how much money went into those two things? Here's what we would do in that room. See the mural that Bob painted on the right? All of that at the top would be gone. It'd be sheetrock. And Bob would carry that sky up over the top and paint, put clouds in it and birds in it, and that when you walk in there, there wouldn't be a ceiling. The same thing with the floor. You don't need the expense of coming through floor. If it was, in fact, it was stamped concrete. It's earthy. It's telling your story. And the expense in this was incredible. And the architect completed the project. And when we started coming in, he says, you're not going to cover my ceiling, are you? Well, we had big acacia trees. We had all kinds of... He was not... Who the hell do they think they are? The rest of the room was a 40,000 square foot home. The rest of the house, fine. Do your thing. This room is different. And if you don't get the right architect and builder, they will not acknowledge that. Same room. I had a client who took me into his trophy room and looked up at the ceiling. He said, I spent $150,000 on the ceiling. Isn't it beautiful? That's what you want to say. That what you built a room for, to show people your ceiling? I would build a room so you don't have a ceiling. Now again, that room, okay, here, this is, again, mural. There is the line tribe that's out in our display against the wall. Here's the line of pride against the mural. The vista goes back 100 miles. Murals open up the room. They can, and if you look at our display, starting as you come in, first of all, you're in New Zealand. Then you're in Savannah of Africa. Then you're in the cliffs of Spain. And then you're in the jungles of Cameroon. You are able to take people into different parts of the world, and it makes the room tell your story. Animals don't exist in a vacuum. It's both art and it's architecturally opening up. Go to the next one. I want to just go through these murals so you can get an idea of what they do. I can't tell you how much I believe in them. They are cost-effective relative to the other architectural features that happen. And with the mural comes the next element, and that is habitat. Like I said, animals don't exist in a vacuum. So in front of the murals, go ahead, is a water bowl. Now, I'm going to show you something here. your standpoint. This looks like a huge area. It's a very small area. This is wall. The mural echoes and pushes it back. Does that make sense? Okay. We paint animals back in the mural to echo the animals that are in the foreground. Jungle, this is one of our favorite ones. People just love to walk in under the vines and feel the jungle. And then we add the animal in front of the habitat, which is in front of the mural, and now you're telling a story about your experience. It's your experience. It's not a dead animal. It's not a severed head. This is what it felt like to be there. Go ahead. There's the cliffs of Spain. Here's Alaska with the fish underneath and the eagle above. That is a subject. Again, I want to show you something. That is a very narrow display. It runs right here. It is probably, even with the fish, it's probably 6 feet. And yet when you look at it that way, you're off course. Okay? Okay, let me talk, and I'm trying to get done because I know everybody wants to get out there and spend their money on the floor, so let me try to get through some of these other issues. Here are some of the do this doorway and all that stuff. Where's that? Go back. I got to share it with you very quickly. I ran past it. What I did when I got up the girls, I ran past it. There's going to be hippos coming out of there. The animals are getting. We're even in that. This way back. Okay. Okay, we went to ceiling height. We went volume, wall height, ceiling height, no windows in the place that is sterile, wall coverings. The wall coverings in between the dioramas should be, this is an earth tone. It can be, there's so many great wall coverings. Again, it should be an earth tone, it should be muted, so that the stars, the displays stand out. The doorways, oh man, this is huge. You cannot believe how many people build a trophy room and never realize how big a doorway they need to get things in and out. We are in the process, one of our favorite clients has a 10,000 square foot trophy room, and we have to get a life-size elephant in that room through a double door. We're building the elephant in pieces to get it through there. And all it would have taken, this is during the meeting with the architect and the builder, is saying, we need to have a big doorway. We can camouflage the doorway. It's not an eyesore, but it's a fundamental to the room working. I talked to you about flooring. Okay, let me talk to you about lighting very quickly. There's three kinds of lighting, and I can't emphasize enough how important lighting is, and lighting should be addressed at the very beginning of designing your room. I've gotten in a lot of trouble by putting it off and thinking, I'm just going to be able to put some lights in. It won't work. You've got to address it right now. And the key is this. You need to have maximum capacity. There's three kinds of lighting. Number one is a general light. So you come in, you kick the lights on, and the room is lit. Number two is specific focused lighting that comes on. Number three is you have to, with these murals, come up and wash the back. Because with the other lighting, it'll cast a shadow, and when you cast a shadow, you tell people it's a wall. Lighting's expensive, but if you do it right, it is worth every penny of it. And let me tell you the fourth kind of lighting. And all I'm doing is giving you the optimum. The fourth kind of lighting is this. It's theater lighting. And theater lighting means that you have a computer with several programs within that computer. And this is a kick. I'm going to get to comfort stations and places where you sit, but picture yourself in your room with a cloudscape, with acacia trees, and your animals sitting around. And I'll talk to you about the bar. The bar is a thatch bar, and you're sitting in African fold-out chairs, and you're remembering an experience. And while you're sitting there, you, the owner, reach over, and unknowingly, you touch a program. And the room starts to go down, and the sun's going down. And you don't sit, and the guest's going down. As it goes down, fiber optics are in the ceiling, and stars start to come out. And about that time, I'm going to get other things. You have some sound effects, and you hear the night sounds of Africa, the croaking frogs, the lions roaring. Even when none of them was great, a tremendous thunderstorm. And then there was the silence after, and all the other things came in. Then, on the east, the light starts to come back up. And you go through a day in Africa. Right? Now that's probably way over the top, but it's a possibility. But you absolutely would love it if you do it. Let me tell you, one of my favorite rooms I did was in Austria. And I did it in a barn that was 150 years old with a guy who was here at the convention today with his son. And he had the good taste saying, he's primarily a sheep hunter. He said, I want this to be a sheep room, sheep of the world. So we laid it out with the different continents, different sheep, different rock structures. And we got done. We brought in a theater lighting guy. Peter's gone most of the time. But he came back when we were at that stage. We were done. The room was done and the lighting was in. And it's one of those moments that makes you want to enjoy your profession. I said, Peter, just stand here. And he stood here, and the room went through that dark situation. In the night, lights would come on a specific room, fade off, and go to the next room. So in the night, in the darkness, each group is being highlighted with different colors, cool colors, ambers, and rose colors. This room is alive as it moves around. And finally, it gets to the last one, the room lifts up. This is an international industrialist, and he stood there, and I'm thinking, he says, brilliant. I want that. There's real, what was happening? We were telling a story, relating an experience. We weren't just collecting dead animals. Okay, almost done, folks. I go all the way through. You don't have to. I can use this. Okay. Here are some ideas. Once you've got the floor plan, you've got the volume, you've got the elements that are going to go into your room. Here's some ideas that will work for you. Number one is stacking. Stacking is both dynamic and space efficient. You can see it out there in the most dangerous game display. At the bottom is the hippo coming out of the water. Then there's the buffalo, lion, and rhino. Then there is the elephant. And then there is the tree with a leopard. It's stacked. It separates the animals. You can put more animals in closer proximity. And the drama of it is a killer. So I really encourage people, even that's when we do mountains, the concept is that we stack them. Now, let me say something about mountains, because everybody's got a rock panel and they think they're an expert at rock mountains. Let me just say, mountains are not a pile of rock. Mountains are rock outcropping surrounded by talus slope and grass benches, and there's contrast. And animals only go to the rocks as an escape terrain. So it is that changing that makes a mountain work. But let me tell you something. If you build a mountain in a room, you need not a big bunch of footprint. Plan ahead in Colorado. Had a relatively small room, but the room was only for North American sheep and goats. And so he says, I just want this to be an alpine room. Perfect. At least we can keep the theme there. He says, but there's three other things I want to have happen. I want to show huge movies as promotion and my own hunting movies. It was a way of motivating his client base. Not his client base, his workers. So the way the whole room was written on the attachments. I'm so ashamed. Anyway, so he said, I got to have a place to show movies to. That means I have to have a seating area. We have to have a screen. I want to have a bathroom in this room because I don't want people, it was connected to his house. He said, I don't want people to have to come back into the house to use the lavatory. And thirdly, he says, I love this because I want a wine cellar in the room. So I got a wine cellar, a bathroom, seating area, and movies. It was so fun. You know what we did? We built a bottle. And at the room, you step down into the room, and that is a wonderful thing to be able to do. The seating area was at the bottom. At the back of the room was the major rock structure. And within the rock structure was an envelope in which the screen went up. When his clients and friends came there, they would sit in the middle of the room with this alpine environment around them. The screen would come down. He would show the movies. When this movie was over, it would go up. And also in that rock structure, because we're using that footprint that ate up probably a quarter to a third of the room, we made a passageway around the boulder to a bathroom. And the bathroom had the same rustic boulders in it. We had another passway around the other side of the rock structure that went into his wine cellar. So we had a wine cellar and a bathroom underneath the mountain, and a stream that went back into the mountain. All the space was utilized because you're going to have to fight to keep your display space. He had one other element, I wish I could take credit for it, but it was stunning. The room backed up to his house, and his master bedroom was on the second floor. He built a balcony out of his master bedroom with French doors so that he could, in the morning or evening, he could take his coffee and his paper, step out into the balcony, and look down on his alpine scene with a mural landscape and his animals. He said, hey, his secretary has told his wife, you can't believe how much he loves this room. And for me, that's better than money. It really means a lot to see that happen. Stacking is a very, very critical issue. We're almost done. Comfort stations. Comfort stations are this. I believe that you have to have a way to feel comfortable in the room. We're doing things now so that when you, or a reception area, we're doing something, for example, like a gentleman's club in Kenya. Lovely paneled walls, bookcases, a few mounted heads, a turn-of-the-century bar, Teddy Roosevelt kind of thing. And from that, you open and step out into an open veranda, and the trophy room, you go down the path, you go into the trophy room. So you're able to do certain things in those introductory areas that wouldn't be appropriate in the rest of the room. And the contrast is lovely. Now, let me tell you, we had another one where the guy wanted to put a bar in the room. And so what we did is we contacted people in Kenya, they made a Kenyan tent, turn of the century, Teddy Roosevelt tent, made it in half. We put it against the wall. He put his bar in there. We put a window in the back of it. So when you come into the tent, you're looking out the window, and a herd of elephants are going through there, painted, obviously. And here's this, you sit there, and you have a drink in those folding African chairs, looking out at the rest of the room, got Paul sitting in the tent. We did it in a North American room, a trapper's cabin. So, because what we need to do in some of these rooms, they get so large, is that you have a reception area, and as you're meandering through the room, at the other end, you want to have a place to stop and view, look back. So, in this was a North American room, we made a trapper's cabin that, again, had a gold bar, had some pros on the roof, had some traps hanging down. really fun, interesting stuff. These rooms done this way appeal not only to the hunter, they appeal to the non-hunter, and even the anti. We have had antis come into our showroom, bristle, look around, and say, now I get it. Now I know why you want it. Without a single word. That's a great game. Your room should have that kind of broad appeal. There's so much more we can go through, but let me close with the 800-pound gorilla that is in the middle of the room. And that's money. I want to ask you something. I ask myself, what do you see? System is rigged. I don't care where you hide it. They're going to get a big chunk of it. Let me address one other thing. If you have some perverse need to leave money to your children, get in therapy. I will say this, and I'm going to tell you, I've lived this. You do not do your kids any favors. My daughter went to a hugely expensive school back east. And she's going to go on to medical school, and she thought daddy was just going to keep writing the check. And I says, Jess, in 6 months, we're done. She was, her jaw dropped. She's unbelievable. My only kid. And I'm a daddy. And she was turning into a bitch. She was in New York, and she didn't have to wear sheep. And I said, Jess, she said, Dad, I want to go to medical school. I said, guess what, honey? That's not my job for you to be a doctor. My job is to teach you to be self-sufficient. And money earned is 1,000 times more satisfying than money received. I said, I don't want to deprive you of the exquisite pain and joy of knowing that you can take care of yourself. You know what? She's in medical school. She took out a loan. She has a car her mom signed for, but she pays it. She is totally self-sufficient, and she still loves her day. Yes? I'm sorry? Yeah, that's the other thing. There is no U-Haul behind the earth. You know, I love what Bear Woodward said, billionaire. He says, my goal, the ultimate financial planning, is to die penniless. He says, I'm going to bounce the check on the Undertaker. What are we saying? Let me hear what happens. Money becomes an end in itself, and we have this idea that money, this is an oxymoron. I'm sorry, I'm going to get off on a rant. You guys can leave me if you want to. But the idea of financial security there is no security in finances. Your security is in your soul. A certain rich man, whose ground brought forth much fruit, said to himself, what shall I do with all my abundance? I know what I do. I will tear down my barns and make bigger barns. And then I will say to my soul, all of a sudden from barns to soul, I will say to my soul, I have much goods laid up for many years. The prophet says, thou fool, today thy soul shall be required of thee. And then who shall those things be? We're in the fourth quarter. We have a moment. It's our moment. We've earned it. Do what works for you. Without apology. Without regret. If you have questions, I'll be at my booth. Thank you for your very kind attention. You've been great.